mycoses like pathogenic fungi, like blastomycosis and histoplasmosis. And again, we don't see that here in our country. And opportunistic fungi like Candida and Aspergillus. We're not really going to discuss that because it's well known for everyone. And when we say Candida, there are Candida albicans, Candida non-albicans. Candida albicans, which is the predominant Candida. We have also Candida non-albicans like Parapsilosis, Tropicalis, Cruzii, and Glabrata. These are the most common Candida non-albicans. And we could see here, this is a smear of urine of Candida albicans, and this is a patient who has Candida albicans. And this is a tongue of patient who has Candida. When we see Aspergillus species, it's usually cutaneous or pulmonary. Cryptococcus neoformans, it's either CNS or pulmonary. And histoplasma is usually pulmonary. And this is, you could see here Aspergillus teres, and this is Aspergillus nidulans, and Aspergillus flavus, and also Aspergillus niger, and Aspergillus fumigatus. And now we'll start with the most common antifungals and invasive fungal infections. Start with bullions like amphotericin B, and also flucytosine. From the azoles, we have ketoconazole, fluconazole, itraconazole, voriconazole, posaconazole, ravuconazole, isavuconazole, and also albuconazole. The last three we are not really going to discuss because they are not really still investigational, except for ravuconazole. We'll have one slide to discuss ravuconazole. Echinocandins. We have three echinocandins: caspofungin, mycofungin, and dulefungin. We start with amphotericin B. This is the first drug that was introduced in 1956. It's pore soluble in water. It's available only. It's available only in suspension. Using sodium deoxycholates, and as a dispersing agent. And precipitates when suspended in acidic or electrolyte solutions. The drug has a huge, spectrum. It's one of the best, when we consider spectrum, it's one of the best antifungals. It's, when we say Candida and Aspergillosis, it's excellent for Candida and excellent for Aspergillus, except for a few exceptions. It's a good drug for blastomycosis, histoplasmosis, and coccidioidomycosis, paracoccidioidomycosis, and also for Cryptococcus neoformans, it's a drug of choice. And for mucormycosis, it's an excellent drug for mucormycosis. It's a good drug for Leishmania, and it's when we say there are limitations, we have here Candida lusitiani and also Candida guillermundi and also Aspergillus teres. It's not going to cover by amphotericin B, and it's less sensitive against Candida cruzii. Pharmacokinetics, absorption, or distribution, I think it's well known to everyone. Metabolism here, we could say only 3% is secreted in the urine as an active drug. It's important to mention that the renal invasion does not affect the clearance, and also hemodialysis does not alter the clearance. It's important to mention adverse effects of this drug because amphotericin B, one of the major limitations of using amphotericin B is adverse effects, like infusion-related. there are two major adverse effects, infusion-related and non-infusion-related. I'm sure even the students, they know about this. For non-infusion-related, we have to know or keep in mind nephrotoxicity is a major non-infusion related. Anemia could be there. Anaphylaxis is rare. Transient dyspnea and hypoxemia. And abnormal liver function, although it's not really common with amphotericin B, thrombocytopenia, and leukopenia. We have three lipid formulations of amphotericin B, and their advantage of over amphotericin B, lower rates of nephrotoxicity, and also the antifungal activity in vitro are comparable to standard amphotericin B or amphotericin B deoxycholates. They have a clinical efficacy similar to amphotericin B, except for for liposomal amphotericin B, while it's, we could say it's more effective, or it has more efficacy in sinusitis, Aspergillus sinusitis. This is a table that shows the three lipid formulations. We have ABCD, ABLS, and liposomal amphotericin B. And in terms of dosing, of course, amphotericin B has limited dosing. You could reach up to 1.5. ABCD 3 to 6. Although this drug is it's not worth mentioning. Also, let's focus on ABLC and liposomal amphotericin B. And for dosing, we cannot exceed 5 milligrams per kg per day for ABLC. And for liposomal amphotericin B, there is a range of dosing for liposomal amphotericin B. Toxicity, they are all toxic, to renal toxic. And infusion-related, liposomal amphotericin B is the least to cause that. Second drug is fluocytosine. This drug was introduced in 1972. It has a limited spectrum, this drug, and it comes in IV or oral. When we discuss this drug, we discuss its spectrum. It's an excellent drug for Candida. It's not going to cover aspergillosis. So keep in mind, this drug is good for Candida and Cryptococcus pneumoformans. Okay, so it's a good drug for aspergillosis by itself, but usually we combine it with amphotericin B. We don't use it by itself at all because of the emergence of resistance. So if you use it today by itself, after 3 days, it will be resistant. What's important about this drug also is adverse effects. That's why we don't use it very often, except in combination in certain cases. Bone marrow suppression is a major with this drug, and hepatotoxicity. So keep in mind that this drug it could cause bone marrow suppression. And dosing and monitoring. It's important to know that this drug should be monitored, and could be monitored in most of the institutions. And we could monitor the peak or the trough, and it's clear here that peak is 550 to 100, or let's say 2 hours after dose, and the trough is 25 to 50 prior to dosing. Azoles, how many minutes?
10 minutes more.
Okay, azoles, mechanism of action of all azoles is the same, okay? They inhibit fungal B450 mediated 14 alpha lansoprazole. So they work in the cell membrane. They don't work in the cell wall like, let's say, echinocandins. So keep that in mind. So it has the same, let's say, mechanism of action like amphotericin B. Mechanism of resistance is efflux. The main mechanism of resistance is efflux. BAMs, drug-drug interactions is major with azoles, like Dr. Ted Martin mentioned earlier. Except for one drug, which is fluconazole, it has lower drug-drug interactions. Voriconazole, you have to keep in mind that this drug has a major, has the most drug-drug interactions. Adverse effects, generally, every single drug has its own adverse effects, but generally, they will increase LFTs, or they could cause hepatotoxicity and GI upset. Fluconazole, this is a drug that has excellent GI absorption, excellent CSF penetration, T-half is 27 to 34 elimination through the urine in 60 to 75% as an unchanged. Toxicity of this drug is almost, mainly increase in ALT. Indications, when we compare it to other azoles, it has limited indications compared to others, or limited spectrum. It's good against, or excellent against, Candida albicans, Candida parapsilosis, Candida tropicalis, but it's not good against Candida glabrata or Candida krusei. The drug is excellent against Cryptococcus with or without 5FC, histoplasmosis, blastomycosis, but it's lower than itraconazole. So it's not really, we cannot say this drug is excellent. It is against histoplasmosis, blastomycosis. And sporotrichosis and coccidioidomycosis, this is an excellent drug. Resistant, like I mentioned, aspergillosis is not going to be covered. Zygomycosis is not going to be covered by fluconazole and fusarium. Itraconazole, I mean, what's good about, before we discuss itraconazole, what's good about fluconazole is pharmacokinetics. So keep that in mind, please. Itraconazole, this is a second drug. What's good about fluconazole is pharmacokinetics. What's bad about itraconazole, it's also pharmacokinetics. It has erratic or poor GI absorption. It will be metabolized through hepatic. So in hepatic insufficiency associated with prolonged half-life, and excretion hepatically cleared, and only 3 to 18 percent excreted through feces, and inactive urinary metabolites 40%. It has three formulations, capsule, solution, and IV. Capsule should be taken with food, and also solution should be taken in empty stomach. Indications of itraconazole, it has better indications than fluconazole. So when we say this drug is a better indication, we're talking about mainly about aspergillosis. This is a good drug for aspergillosis, okay? Also, for blastomycosis, histoplasmosis, onychomycosis, this is an excellent drug for onychomycosis. And for candidiasis, is better than fluconazole. Of course, this drug inhibits by CYP3A4, so keep in mind that it will interact with so many drugs. Toxicity for this drug, nausea, vomiting, rash, also hypokalemia, diarrhea, congestive heart failure, neuropathy. That's the main toxicity, and increase in LFTs, of course. Voriconazole, it was introduced into the market in 2002, and this drug is different. We could compare it in terms of pharmacokinetics. We could compare it to fluconazole. So it has an excellent absorption. In terms of indications or let's say spectrum, it's better than others, except for onychomycosis with the itraconazole. And like itraconazole, it will be hepatically cleared. Dosing here is not really important. It has so many indications compared to others. It's a drug of choice for Aspergillus, okay. And if it's in the brain or in the lungs, it doesn't matter. It's a drug of choice, okay. And then we can look at other antifungals. And for hyphomycosis and let's say for Fusarium, this is a good drug compared to others because they don't really cover. And Pseudosporium and Abiosporium, it's a good drug. Toxicity. Abnormal vision, increase in LFTs like other antifungals, rash, fever, and QT interval prolongation. Interaction, it will interact like others. Busaconazole, it was introduced in 2006. Indications, prophylaxis of invasive aspergillus and candida infections. In high risk, severely immunocompromised, aged 13 years and older. And treatment of oropharyngeal candidiasis, including treatment of oropharyngeal candidiasis refractory to itraconazole or fluconazole. It comes in liquid, this drug, and activity like voriconazole with some zygomycetes, okay. Although it's not really a drug of choice for aspergillus, but it has activity against aspergillosis. And it has activity against, like I said, Fusarium. And it will be metabolized through the liver. Adverse effects of busaconazole, increased LFT, QT prolongation, headache, rash, nausea, vomiting, hypokalemia, neutropenia. Ravuconazole, this is the drug investigational. It's a derivative of fluconazole with potent activity against candida species, aspergillus, Cryptococcus neiformans, histoplasma, and candida in vitro. It's fungicidal, which is, advantage of this drug. And activity of ravuconazole against Fusarium and Pseudosporium is less than voriconazole. So this is advantage of voriconazole over ravuconazole. Cross-resistance between fluconazole and ravuconazole has been observed also with Candida glabrata and other Candida species. Has no activity against ribosus and mucor species. The safety and tolerability is comparable to fluconazole in adult patients. And echinocandins, we have three echinocandins, and generally speaking, they work in the cell wall of the mammalian or let's say the fungi. So they are the only one work in the cell wall. So it has different mechanism of action. We could use that in combination. Spectrum of echinocandins, candida, they are candida species, aspergillus species, and Haemocystis carinii. They have poor activity against mucor, Cryptococcus neiformans, Fusarium, and Trichosporin asahi. class adverse effects, they don't really have a major adverse effects in general echinocandins. Though this is an advantage for echinocandins. And they have histamine, like histamine reaction, flushing, pruritus, and low blood pressure, phlebitis, fever, and mild LFT elevations. And this is different from one drug to another, LFT elevations. We have three caspofungin, micafungin, and eulafungin. And the first two drugs, they will be metabolized by the liver. The third one, and eulafungin, it will not be metabolized through the liver, and it will be metabolized in the serum, which is an advantage of this drug. Caspofungin.
Actually, because there was 10 minutes from the other speaker, that's why it's up to you. If you finish, it's fine. Now it's 25 minutes.
25.
But you have 5 minutes if you still have more slides.
Okay, thank you. Caspofungin is the first drug of this class. Indications of caspofungin, it has the main indications or the major indications of this class. Empiric antifungal therapy of febrile neutropenia and treatment of invasive aspergillosis, treatment of esophageal candidiasis, and treatment of candidemia and disseminated candidemia. This is the major indications of caspofungin. Drug-drug interactions, it has lower drug-drug interactions if we compare caspofungin to azoles. Even if we compare it to fluconazole. However, we have to keep in mind that it will interact with some protease inhibitors and also with cyclosporin and tacrolimus. So we have to keep that in mind. And also phenytoin, rifampin, dexamethasone, and carbamazepine, it will interact with. And pharmacokinetics, it will be metabolized in hepatic, elimination hepatically cleared, and 41% and 35% of the dose will be excreted through feces and renal, respectively. The elimination half-life is almost 10 hours. Adverse reactions of caspofungin, it has limited adverse reactions. Like fever, rash, nausea, vomiting, phlebitis, and increased LFTs. Second one is micafungin. Indications of micafungin is treatment of candidemia, acute disseminated candidiasis, candida peritonitis, and abscesses. Treatment of esophageal candidiasis. And prophylaxis against candida infections in patients undergoing stem cell transplant. Pharmacokinetics of this drug, it will be hepatically cleared, like 75%, with 70% excreted through the feces, and only 15% will be excreted with the urine. The drug has poor absorption with distribution of 0.28 to distribution of 0.28 to 0.5 liter per kilogram. It will drug interactions is almost it's lower than caspofungin. However, it will interact with sirolimus, nifedipine. Adverse reactions of micafungin. It's similar to caspofungin. However, isolated cases of significant hemolysis and hemolytic anemia have been observed. This is a warning. This is from the EMEA only. It's not really a warning. FDA, they do not mention anything about this. It's a precaution. It's a development of hepatocellular tumors in rats after 3 months of exposure to to make a fungin. They did not really, I mean, FDA, they did not really comment on this one. They did not mention anything. However, it's good to mention or keep in mind also.
Okay, just 1 minute more.
Okay, and the dual fungin, this is the last, a few slides only. The last one is anidula fungin indications, treatment of candidemia and other forms of candida infections, intra-abdominal abscesses and peritonitis, treatment of esophageal candidiasis. Pharmacokinetics, this drug is different from when we say it's different from caspo fungin and mica fungin in terms of metabolism. It will not be metabolized through the liver. It will be metabolized in the serum. Adverse effects, like other echinocandins, rash, urticaria, flushing, abnormal LFTs, and hypotension. Drug interactions, it will not interact with other drugs because it's not really hepatically metabolized. This is a slide for TDM with antifungals. We have three drugs here, itraconazole, voriconazole, and also posaconazole. Itraconazole, I'm not going to say should be monitored, but it could be monitored to ensure safety and efficacy, and targeted level is 1.5 microgram per ml, and it should be through the trough after 7 days of therapy. Voriconazole, why do we do voriconazole monitoring? In patients with progressive disease, it could be done, patients exhibiting significant visual and hepatic toxicity, it could be also done in patients at risk of fluctuating plasma levels. Targeted level here is 2 to 6 microgram per ml, and it should be after 7 days after starting therapy, and the trough only. Posaconazole, there is no standard for posaconazole. However, in patients with progressive disease, posaconazole draw the level. We could do that, and also the level should be around 1.25 microgram per liter, and we could do the peak only, not the trough. This is two slides only about combination therapy. What is the advantage and disadvantage of combination therapy of antifungals? Advantage is usually we have three advantages: enhanced rate and extent of killing, like say synergy, increased spectrum of activity, decreased likelihood of resistance. Disadvantage: decreased rate and extent of killing, which is antagonism. Increased risk of drug interactions, increased toxicity, and increased cost. And this is a table I got from IDSA for combination therapy. We could see here for aspergillus or aspergillosis, invasive pulmonary aspergillosis. For primary therapy, it's not recommended. Combination therapy is not really recommended. Salvage therapy, we could consider that. And for candida, it's different. Candidemia, not recommended for routine management, CNS, candidiasis, liquid formulations of amphotericin B plus or minus flocytosine. And candida, endophthalmitis, amphotericin B plus flocytosine. So most of the candidas we can combine with let's say amphotericin B with or without flocytosine. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Abdullah. It is the time for the speakers to come to the stage for discussion.
They will bang it now.
Okay, we can start discussion. Go ahead.
Yes, salam alaikum. Very interesting topics, I must say. I just have a quick question for the last speaker. I understand posaconazole is not available on formulary here. Are we, if we try to put it through, will we be able to get it? This is my understanding. Because it is very helpful, and we've seen a lot of patients that would benefit from the use of it.
To have it as a formulary or to have it as a non-formulary for patients?
I mean, you know, to at least
we could,
have
we could
it.
Have it. I mean, for if we have patients, you could request it as a non-formulary. For as a formulary, this is another, it's another discussion.
All right, thank you.
Because it needs guidelines also.
Yes, Dr. Ashwar.
Thank you, Dr. Amin, for the overview about the HIBIC. A question, is there any literature about the quality of life of patients on HIBIC compared to other modalities like palliative care or systemic chemotherapy?
Thank you for that question. I didn't get the time to include these slides. There has been a lot of studies on the quality of life, and most studies have shown that in the first 6 months, the patients do suffer in terms of mobility, food, and so on. But after 6 months to a year, most patients go back to normal, and the quality of life is pretty good. And all the patients at that time have said that it's been really worthwhile for them to go with the procedure. But in the first 6 months, yes, it is because of the extent of the surgery. Most of the problem arise from that.
What are the recent changes in the antifungal management by drugs for the last 5 years?
What do you mean by drugs?
You mean there's like prescribing, you know, certain drugs came to the market, some other removed. Before, I remember one time we have itraconazole, we use a lot, but then now we're using more of voriconazole, cefepime.
Now we have pusaconazole. We have pusaconazole, and also we have two echinocandins like micafungin and anidulopungin within the last, let's say, 5 years. Itraconazole, we used to use it. It used to be a drug of choice for aspergillosis. Nowadays, it's not. It's no longer. So we have three drugs, let's say, pusaconazole, within the last five years. Pusaconazole, anidula, and micafungin.
Yes.
So one question for Dr. Billa Mohez. With regards to TDM for antifungals, what is your opinion regarding the feasibility or the appropriateness of using, in particular, voriconazole?
I think we have to do TDM for voriconazole and for itraconazole. For pusaconazole, because there is no standard, it was difficult. But for voriconazole in specific, I think it's important to do that because we have fluctuation let's say, in response of patients, we are not really sure about the, let's say, about the absorption of the drug. So I think it's important.
And for Dr. Amin, from your experience so far, do you think HIPEC is a good therapy for your patients?
HIPEC has become the standard treatment now. I think it's become the standard treatment for patients with peritoneal carcinomatosis, and you should compare all other therapies with HIPEC rather than the old traditional way, which was a standard, old traditional way, which was had no evidence for it. But now we have far more evidence in terms of phase two and phase three trials, and just with the volume of patients and the results, to indicate that this is really is a standard treatment for patients with peritoneal carcinomas. I mean selected patients with peritoneal carcinomatosis, not all of them.
Our patients here, like we have done a number of patients, you're feeling about, you see patients
involved. Oh, definitely, definitely. We have exactly the same results. Some patients have had recurrence, some patients now we're seeing, since we started the program 2 years, we've had some patients with no evidence of disease, and really remarkable how they get back to their normal life when they had extensive carcinomatosis, big abdomen with ascites, and now they're going back to normal life.
Yeah.
Very impressive.
Do you have a statistics for number of patients, Dr. Tayek? Dr. Tayek, I mean?
Oh, for our patients?
Do you have a statistic? Because actually we didn't start this intraperitoneal chemotherapy in our institution. So how many patients do you have in King Faisal?
We've started the program from November 2 years ago, so that's almost now 2 years. We've done so far 32 cases. We had issues with the machinery, and we had to stop 3 months to get the company to give us the support, and so on. So we had all these growing pains to grow, but the program is going well, and the number of patients actually is increasing quite tremendously that I feel myself as a lone surgeon doing it, I would not be able to cope with that. I think we're going to have to get the team.
What about the incidence of complications?
The complication is similar to the complication of major surgery. So it's not very much different than patients who've had major surgery. But the problem with peritoneal carcinomatosis, when we did major surgery before for them, the disease recurred very quickly in 6 months. But now the patients will get the recurrence in small locations, smaller volume, but maybe 2 years later. But a significant number, depending on the disease, will have a cure. Like some of the colorectal, you're talking about cure in about 40 to 50% of patients, which was not heard of before.
Yeah, thank you. I have a question for Ted Martin, because we have a student here from King Saud University, maybe educational for them. If the patient is new to a clinic but afebrile, what is your recommendation regarding to initiating antibiotics?
If they're neutropenic but afebrile?
Yes. Will you start antibiotic or not? What about? Because some of the guidelines, they don't recommend initiation of antibiotic if the patient is new to a clinic. So yeah. What is your recommendation?
Don't give them antibiotics.
Don't start.
Now, let me be clear. If the patient is a specific high-risk patient, as we define, yes, particularly the stem cells transplant patients, there is benefit from prophylaxis, specifically with ciprofloxacin and some older studies with trimsulfa. But that's prophylaxis. That's not treatment.
Okay.
For a patient who is neutropenic, though, starting broad-spectrum intravenous antibiotics prior to the onset of fever does not provide any benefit. Another interesting question would be what's called empiric versus preemptive antifungal therapy. You know, when we look at antifungal therapy, that's usually started after a treatment fail, well, not in response after about 4 days. Some authorities have looked at using clinical signs and symptoms like galactomannan or CTs with halo signs and things like that to identify patients who might benefit from preemptive fungal therapy without regard to whether or not their temperature responds. The problem they found with that is you end up with a lot of invasive fungal infections that you miss with the preemptive strategy. You're actually better off just treating based on the presence of persistent fever on broad-spectrum antibacterials. But the short answer is, if they don't have a fever and they don't have other, dysuria or positive bug cultures, don't start broad-spectrum antibiotics. All you're doing is increasing risk of side effects and your risk of resistance developing when they do actually spike a fever.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions?
Yes.
Yeah.
To the patient with renal impairment, patient who has like partial
impairment, not giving just the dose. Yeah, actually, we go and for those type of patients, we reduce the dose by 50% for cisplatin. And for other agents, also for mitomycin, although it's hepatic eliminated, still we reduce the dose by 30%.
Okay, by the end of the session, I would like to thank all our distinguished speakers, and I think it's the time for the closing ceremony. Thank you.
Okay, I'd like to ask everybody to be seated, please. I'd like to ask all speakers, moderators to be available. With the last session, I'd like to thank all of our distinguished national and international speakers, our moderators. I would like also to extend my thanks and gratitude to our organizing committee members, as well as the scientific committee members. Without you, we couldn't have done it. I think this was a very successful short conference, 2 days conference, and I hope in the future we'll have our next oncology pharmacy practice conference in about 2 years or so. It could be, inshallah, in a different hospital, as I heard that it's moving now from one hospital to another. Again, I would like to call for the names of our national and international speakers so we can hand them their plaques of our appreciation, showing our appreciation to them.
I can't leave you from that mission. I'll say the names. We'll start with the organizing committee. Mr. Muhammad Ashour, the coordinator for the organizing committee of the Oncology Pharmacy Practice Symposium. Mr. Zubair Nerget. Abdurrahman al-Husseini. Dr. Mazen Assaf. Ms. Jean Ann Galan, the secretary of the organizing committee. I think she's shy. She's not coming to pick her bag. And we'll move on. Myself, I'm Amal Al-Aqil. I'll leave my bag for later.
Okay.
Scientific committee, Dr. Najwa Ibrahim. Dr. Lamia Naim from King Saud University. She is not going to be able to pick her plate. She is in the States at the moment. We'll move on to international speakers, Dr. Graham Sewell.
Thank you.
it's freezing now. Mr. William Churchill from the United States. Dr. Haitham Tufaha from Jordan. Our local speakers, Dr. Abdullah Nasser and Dr. Tahir Tuwajri, Dr. Naeem Chaudhary and Dr. Shoki Bazirbashi, and Dr. Tarek Amin from the Medical Department of Medical Oncology. Mr. Hakim Hakim from Pharmacy Division. Dr. Abdullah Al-Mhezi from Pharmacy Division. Dr. Ted Morton from King Khaled University Hospital. You have to change your citizenship now. That's you're right. A Saudi.
Okay, thank you.
Dr. Asim Balgomi and Dr. Yusuf Al Ola, Dr. Muhammad Asiri, they will not be able to pick their plates today. Our distinguished moderators, Dr. Amani Bahdela, Dr. Nadal Ghazib, and Mr. Ammar Hijazi. Mr. Maher will receive the plaque on his behalf. Sponsors of the of this event, the platinum sponsors, GlaxoSmithKline Company. Roche Pharmaceuticals. The gold sponsor. The gold sponsor, Bayer Pharmaceuticals. Silver sponsors, AstraZeneca, Bristol-Myers, Sanofi Aventis, and AbbVie. And we would like to help the members from pharmacy who helped in organizing this event, Mr. Adel Hamedan, Dr. Adel Hamedan, and Mr. Maher Mu'mina, Mr. Bandar Al-Amri, Mr. Aris Vivyar, and Ms. Bishair Al-Balkhi, Ms. Zaina Al-Abdul Kareem, and Ms. Haifa Al-Janubi, Mr. Ali Al-Dosari, and Ms. Lara Niangra. And at the end of that, we would like, on behalf of all of the members of the organizing committee, to thank our chairman, and thank you for your support and commitment in getting this event out to reality. Thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed Ejder. I'm a conservative lady. Thank you very much, everyone.